Sunlight hurts my eyes, and something without want of love bears heavy on my mind. Then I look at you, and the world's all right with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day. Instead of me, always seems to know the way.
Hey everyone, I want to thank you all for joining us this evening for another session of Open Air, an ongoing series presented by the Harvey B. Gantt Center. This evening we have a wonderful guest, Earlie Hudnall Jr. will be joining us. His conversation with me today is actually a part of the current exhibition at the Harvey B. Gantt Center, Vision and Spirit, African American Art Works from the Bank of America Collection. It's on view at the Gantt Center until July 31st. You can go to the Gantt Center's website where you can sign up for timed entry to see the exhibition. I want to just start off by reading a brief bio of our guest today, Earlie Hudnall Jr. He started photography while serving in the Marines during the Vietnam War in the 1960s. He received the BA in art education at Texas Southern University and has been their university photographer since 1990. James Laxton, cinematographer for the Academy Award-winning film Moonlight, mentioned Hudnall as a visual inspiration on how the film should depict African-Americans both aesthetically and symbolically. Mr. Hudnall's photographs are in many notable public and private collections across the United States, including the Smithsonian Museum. I just wanna take a moment here and welcome Earlie Hudnall Jr. to the conversation. There you are.
I'm here.
How are you today, Mr. Hudnall?
Well, I'm good. Just a little chill here in Houston, but we're doing fine.
Well, listen, I want to say thank you for committing to doing this today. I know that the weather and circumstances in Texas and other parts of the country as well have been very challenging the past couple of days. And we're just really, you know, pleased that you were able to be with us today.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
So, you know, this is the kind of conversation that I get really excited to have because you're an artist that I don't personally know. We've never had a conversation with one another before. And you might have thought over the course of the last couple of days of seeing me in Zooms as we're kind of getting prepared for this, that I might be like, you know, a shy or reserved person. But really what I've been doing is I've been saving all of my questions and all of my energy for our live conversation because I have so many things that I want to ask you. So, okay. You know, it's just a pleasure for me. So, you know, we're going to talk for about 45 minutes or so, and then we'll open it up for the viewers, the audience, to ask questions. And I just want to begin at the beginning. Talk to me about the first time you picked up a camera. Let's start there. That's an interesting place to start. Let's do that.
Well, the first time I picked up a camera, let's go back before that. The first time that I had an inkling about photography was in a physics class in high school. The instructor was teaching us the difference between a physical change and a chemical change. The physical change, he took a match, piece of paper, and he lit it. Boom. So that was visual. The chemical change, he asked us if we had cameras at home, or our families had cameras, asked us to bring negatives from the drugstore negatives, to school. And he set up a light box with the developer, the stop bath, and the fixer. And we made contact sheets. Click 1001, 1002, you drop the paper into the developer, and magic, the image began to appear. And it goes so far, and you stop it, and it goes into the developer. I mean, to the stop bath. That was my first inkling with photographer from the experience. But the first time that I picked up the camera, I probably handed it to my father, who was an amateur photographer, who made pictures of us on Sundays, special holidays, when we got new school clothes. I had three brothers, and we were staff step, all and two sisters. And we came 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, believe it or not. And so that was a hand-me-down. Every year, I got a new jacket. My brother got my jacket, and my brother Ernest got Jerry's, and then Walter got Pat's. So that's the way it was a hand-me-down. And so my father, as an amateur photographer, he had a camera that he had purchased in Joliet, Illinois. So this was during the summer, and we was up at the swimming pool. I had taken my father's camera without his permission and went up there, and I was making some photographs. And lo and behold, I dropped the camera in the swimming pool. Oh, the lifeguard came off the diving board, got the camera, gave it to me. I went home, I opened it up and shook the water out of it. And believe it or not, you know, in the South, in one of the rooms in the house, you have an attic, and you have a door that you push back, and you get up on the ladder in a chair, and then you can crawl up in the attic. I hid the camera in the attic. Nothing was never said about it, because each year my father worked at Hercules, and they was one of the gifts that they gave to the employees was a camera. So he got a little bit of a more of a modern camera. So years later, we talked about that, and he said, I know what happened to the camera. And so we just laughed about it and went on. But my father was my inspiration early on, because my grandmother, who lived next door to us, and we spent a lot of time over there, was like the community historian. She kept an obituaries. She kept all kinds of school events. School kids would give Miss Bonnie Jean school pictures. And she had this album, and she had stuff chronicled in the album. She had our first nursery rhyme, our first Easter program. She had dates of that, you know, written down that particular way. And during the summertime, she would tell us stories of how things worked when she was a girl growing up. And people would pass and say, hey, Miss Bonnie Jean. And she said, that's Hubbard Harrell. She said, go in there and get Grand's album and bring it here. And she would show us pictures of how he was when he was a small boy. And at an early age, I began to understand the importance of documenting one's community, who we are and what we do each and every day. And that was an article about Jesse L. Brown, the first African-American Navy flyer. He grew up in my neighborhood. He was much older. He went to Ohio State. He became a flyer, and he was shot down over Korea. She had the little clipping of that. And then there was another clipping. A Negro man pulled from jail and lynched by the mob. That was in Poplarville, Mississippi. I have those two articles today. And I remember the importance of that. And it was a minister, old minister, dug this man's grave. And so these are the kinds of things that have stuck with me over the years. The storytelling that my grandmother would tell, visiting communities and trying to learn as much as I possibly can about how the average everyday person survives and lives and how we coexist with nature. This is what is important to me.
Wow, wow. Thank you so much for sharing that. So that leads me to some other questions I have for you. So that's early inspirations, the things that inspire you to want to document your community, to want to tell the story of the people that are around you. Your bio, at least the one I read, it starts off talking about your being a photographer while you were in the Vietnam War. Can you talk a little bit about how that played a role into your photography?
Well, all during high school and up until the time I joined the Marine Corps, I very seldom, with the incident that I had at the swimming pool and dropping the camera in there, I don't think that I ever picked up a camera again. But my father made pictures when he was in military service. I was able to look back and see him as a young man, or younger, during the time that he was in the military. And so when I joined the Marine Corps and out of boot camp, the first thing that I ended up doing was to purchase a small camera, which was the Instamatic camera, the Kodak kind that you advance and you put the cartridges in. Yeah. And so after boot camp, I began to make pictures. When we went to advanced infantry training, if I had an opportunity, I made a photograph. When we was aboard ship, sailing to Hawaii, to the Philippines for advanced infantry training, and then off the coast of Vietnam, I made pictures. When we landed in Vietnam, we did a beachhead landing, the Marines did. I was in the second wave. I had a little camera, I made photographs. When we were in buildup areas where people had to pass, I made photographs if I had an opportunity, and photographs of the guys and so forth. So this is my first introduction to handling a camera. And for me, it was very natural and I enjoyed it and so forth. Composition wise, I had no problem. Approaching a person to make a picture, I had no problem. And even in the field where some things were tragically and things that happened that isn't so beautiful, I was able to make a few photographs. Not a whole lot, because in some instances they confiscated pictures from people.
And right. I was gonna ask you about that. I gotta imagine, you know, you're taking photographs during a war.
Yeah.
So I imagine there's some things you photographed that they didn't want you to keep.
That is true. But see, Vietnam was more or less like, you go on patrol, you may have a skirmish, and you come back. Or you go into an area and you clear it out, and 2 weeks later, you're back in the same area. So it wasn't that was a solid front line. There was pockets of resistance in areas that we had to go into. A lot of time we went to the field in helicopters, most of the times. A lot of the times we went to the field on night patrols. And sometimes we occupied areas where we was like at Hill 861, where we spent a couple of weeks there with the foxhole and from an observation standpoint of view. And I was an 81 millimeter mortar platoon. And so with the line companies out in the field, the grunts, they were called in for fire, and then we would provide that. And this is the thing that I ended up doing while I was in Vietnam. So I had an opportunity from time to time to make a few photographs.
Uh-huh. Right. Well, that's really, really great. I mean, let's talk about making that leap, or maybe it's not even so much of a leap, but so clearly you were committed to taking photographs for a significant portion of your life, even up until that time. It was something that you were curious about. Obviously, while you were in Vietnam, it's something that you did when you could. But how did you make that transition to being what could be called like a more sort of like a artist photographer or commercial photographer? Like where did that change over start to happen?
Well, I came to Texas on the recommendation of a friend of mine, high school friend named Alfred Blackwell Silsby Todd Jr. He was out of school on academic probation. And I was out of the Marine Corps And I had planned to go to University of Southern Mississippi, either to Southern University in Baton Rouge, and mainly to Baton Rouge because my best friend at the time, Morris Pickford, had joined the Marine Corps. And I was, at the time, was working, this was after high school, in Chicago at Republic Steel Mill. And Morris wrote me a letter, told me that he was in the Corps, and he was at 8th and I in Washington, D.C. at the Marine Corps Barracks. And so I immediately quit my job, went home in January 1966. By January the 6th, I joined the Marine Corps, went through boot camp. So after leaving the Marine Corps in January of 1968, I was home. Alfred Todd was home on academic probation. And I was at his house, and his mother and I and Todd was talking. And I told him what my plans were. I was going to study art. And he said, hey, man, why don't you come and go to Texas Southern? They have a good art department. I said, get me an application. So he did. He got me the application. I filled it out. And I rode the Greyhound bus all the way from Hattiesburg, Mississippi to Houston, Texas, got off the bus, still on the concrete, took a taxi cab, came to TSU. Cab stopped in front of Lanier Hall for men. Got out the cab, and they said, hey, crap, don't touch the grass. And one guy said, man, don't mess with that joker. Said, you see, he got a Marine Corps duffel bag. Said, he's crazy. He just come from Vietnam. So that was the first Texas soil that I touched. Now, not the concrete, not the ground, but the dirt, the actual Texas saw was at Texas Southern University. So I was at TSU, went to the art department, took a class in art. I was an art major. First art seminar, John Bigger said, art is life. One must draw upon his personal experiences, family, community, your experiences, and what we are all about. And that stuck with me. So I had a camera, and in my first class for a painting, we had to do something from nature. And ironically, I decided to make a photograph of a cross tie on a railroad. My father actually was a switchman on the railroad. And so I was drawn to the track because to get to the art department, we had to cross that track every single day. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I end up doing that. So other kids in the art department, students begin to ask me, hey man, can you make a picture for me to do a modeling thing? Can you do this and can you do that? I said, yeah, okay. So in 70 or 71, I took a class in photography from Mr. Evans. I'm still a art major, but I took the class in photography as an elective. So Mr. Evans in that class, he saw that I was more advanced than most of the students, so I became his student assistant. So I was working in Hannah Hall at Texas Southern University. There's more than 156 murals on the administration building that John Biggers, as a mural painter and educator, had students to do. This was a requirement for graduation. So here I was working on the wall on a ladder. And a man walks up to me and said, are you Earlie Hudnall? I said, yes, I am. He said, my name is Dr. Thomas L. Freeman. I need a photographer. I said, okay. He said, well, Mr. Evans sent me to see you. Will you come to my office and talk to me? I said, yes, I will. So I went over to talk to him, and he told me what he wanted. The Model Cities program on Tuesdays and Thursday nights, we had to go out and make photographs of the different sessions they had there in the building. And on the other days, we would go out into the community, and this is how I was introduced into the Houston community, and make pictures of the residents, how they live, and the things they end up doing. So, but unbeknown to me, Todd, my buddy who was out of school, it was Tom Freeman, Dr. Thomas L. Freeman, had put him out on academic probation. So here I was in connection with Dr. Freeman. I started with him in 1970, and I worked for him off and on and with the debate team up until 2019 when I left the university. And so that marriage was born. And then I met a guy on campus on Juneteenth, 1969, named Nathaniel Sweet. His father was a newspaper editor in East St. Louis, Illinois. And Nathaniel Sweet was a photographer major. In the photographic lab, Mr. Evans also served as a university photographer. And so the students, other than that 2 hours we had during the class period, we couldn't get back in to develop any film. But one day I was out, and it was Juneteenth in Texas on Juneteenth. They would bring a load of Hempstead watermelons to the campus, and all of the students would get 1/4 of a melon. They would cut melons, and Sweets was out there making photographs. And I said, "Hey man, I got a camera in my room." I said, he said, "Well, why don't you go and get it? I can develop the film." I said, "Okay." I ran up and got my camera, came back, and we shot pictures. He developed the film in his room using the water out of his aquarium to wash the film and so forth and on. And that was my start. And I went to Mr. Evans one day. They said, "You need to go see Mr. Evans." I had my negatives and I had spots on them. And I went over to the lab and I knocked on the door, and this man came to the door. And this was just before I took the class. And he pulled the door behind him just like he was hiding something. He had on a white shirt, short sleeve, a thin beetle tie, gray pants, salt and pepper hair. I said, "Mr. Evans," I said, "I was told to come and see you. My negatives," I said, "I got spots on it." He took it and held it up and looked at it. He said, "You're not agitating." I said, "Agitating?" He said, "Yes, sir." And he closed the door on me. So I was baffled. So I went back to the art department, because we can hang out there from 7 o'clock in the morning to 10 o'clock at night. And somebody told me, he said, "Hey, Hudnall, there's a dark room in the art department." And so one day, Dr. Bigelow walking down the hallway with sandals on, I can see him now, white sock, white trousers, and a white dashiki. I said, "Dr. Bigelow," I said, "I heard there was a dark room in the art department, and I was wondering if I could use it." He said, "Show, man." He reached his hand in his pocket. He handed me the key. He didn't go in and say, and it was through the printing room. He didn't say, "You have to do this, you have to do it." He handed me the key. Man, I went in there and opened the door, and I saw this enlarger. I saw the trays. I saw the safe light, and it was a private room. I ran across campus. I ran and found Sweets. We went downtown to Southwest Cameron, bought a box of paper, and came back. He took me through the dark room. High school came back to me from the time that I were in that class, 1001, 1002. Photography for me was born that day, at that time. And I've been in it ever since from there. Nathaniel Sweet took me through the dark room that one time. I've been on my own ever since. Started making pictures in the art department. Started making pictures for Dr. John Biggers. And then my good friend, best brother, Ray Carrington, who teaches photography over at Jack Yates. It has a program called Eye on Third Ward, was a yearbook editor. And he had heard about me through some other people, so he sent for me. He said, "Man, I have a queen, and I need a picture of her. And we're on deadline." And he said, "I need to finish these pages in the book, and I don't have enough pictures." He said, "Do you have anything?" So I said, "Yeah." So I went back and bought a bunch of pictures, and he laid them out on the floor. He said, "Something old, something new. Black men are worth their weight in gold." And that was 1970. And I shot the pictures of the queen, and Ray and I has been together ever since. And so this is how photography was born for me. Then I began to make pictures around campus for different students at different things. I began to kept working for Dr. Freeman with the Model Cities program. That's the only thing that kept me going and hustling. And so I ended up doing that. And in 1978, I was hired by the university. And in 1990, I became a university photographer after Mr. Evans retired.
Uh-huh. That's tremendous. I mean, and your recollection for all of these things is so, so great. I mean, the way you describe what he was wearing, I mean, that's probably a better description than I can even describe what I have for breakfast. I mean, that's so sort of like with you, so present, you know? And so A lot of what you just described, these are things that happened in the 1970s, right? So 1970, sure. mid-70s. So 1970, if my math serves me correctly, in 1970, you are 24 years old?
Approximately, yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah. Got born in 46. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Right, right. Yeah. So the 70s, you're in your mid-20s. So let's fast forward a little bit. Mm-hmm. Because I want to talk about some more things before we actually start looking at some of your photographs and discuss. So many of the works that you're known for are works or photographs of people from your community. And I know that there are a lot of photographers today who have a very different relationship with photography than someone like you or other photographers who have been in the world longer, working longer. Because of cell phones, obviously so many people have a camera in their pocket. You know, we could go into that later. But can you talk about how do you decide to photograph someone? What is that process like for you?
Well, I learned very early on from the stories that my grandmother would sit on the porch and tell when she would be sitting out there, especially in the summertime, late in the evenings. And about dusk in the summertime and the mosquitoes would start to flying around. And she said, go in the house and get some of Gran's cloth by the sewing machine and bring it back and put it in a bucket and light it and then pat it out and it would smoke. And she would tell very vivid stories how things worked when she was a girl growing up. And that began to resonate with me. Then seeing my father who worked on the railroad and then would come home and get up in the morning. And believe it or not, he had a mule named Cora that I did not like at all because we lived close to the county line, but we was just the footstep into the city and about 5 blocks from the high school. So in the mornings when we would wake up, my daddy would be in the garden, no shirt on, cover hauls, one strap hanging down, broken shoe, saying, get up, Cora, ha, here, left, ha, ha. And we look out the window. He said, you boys, get up, get up, get up, get up. He said, the cows is out and the chickens are out. And we didn't have cows, but we had chicken. And he said, get up, get up. And so to see the sweat pop off of him and how hard he worked and then worked as a switchman, when I see people in certain symbols and things in our culture, that tells me that I have to make the picture. And so this is how I am motivated. I am motivated by people, our action, how we laugh, how the sun reflects off of our skin and so forth and on, our mannerism, our movement, our struggles of what we do from day to day and so forth and on. So these things have always been important to me as a boy growing up in a close-knit community where everyone knew everyone, and then you see people. There was a man named Mr. Mack, and we see Mr. Mack during the summertime in the morning when we was up early. At 6:30, Mr. Mack be passing our house, walking. He worked for a place called Wilmot Gas. He would have a corn pipe in his mouth. He had his coveralls on. He said, I'm going to meet the man. I'm going to meet the man. And we said, hey, Mr. Mack. And so he would be there, and he would be walking in the morning. So it was these kinds of things that really comes, that it stimulates me from the gut. The campus, the variety of students that we have, the international students at the university over the years, I was motivated by that. The Greeks, how they dance and how they move, the young ladies, how they walk and how they look, the clothes they wear, the guys, the same thing, the football team, the basketball team, the laughter, the anguish, the win, the defeat, the crime, the memorial services, churches, the patting of the feet, as I experienced as a small boy in Meridian, Mississippi at prayer in the evening before service would start. These are the things that keep coming back to me over and over and over again. And wherever I find these symbols, wherever I travel, whether I'm in Europe, whether I'm in Mexico, whether I'm in Argentina, or whether I'm in New York, in Harlem, or whatever, I look for these things. And this is what motivates me.
Wow. So I want to move into showing some of your photographs. And I know that we'll start that slideshow now. So before I ask you questions about the particular images here, I just wanted to talk to you about something really, really, really quickly, like technically. So you mentioned developing your own pictures back sure. when, you know, back then. Do you still develop your own pictures?
Every photograph you've ever seen of Earlie Hudnall that was a archival silver gelatin print or an RC print that was used for press was printed by me all of these years, and I still use the darkroom. I still have a darkroom in my home, and I make all of my own photographs.
That's fantastic. And what about cameras? Do you use a similar camera today that you used years ago? How has that been evolving for you as well?
Well, you know, the camera is only a tool for me. And people are asked, what camera are you using? What cameras are you shooting with? 35 millimeter, I shoot with a Nikon. Recently, within the last 10, 12 years, I was able to acquire a Leica. Medium format, I shoot with a 2.25, which is called an Hasselblad. I started with a Yashica Mat 124G. And to tell you that story, my first football game at the university, a friend of mine who is now deceased most recently, named Alvin McEwen, who was Mr. Evans' student assistant ahead of me, came to my apartment to pick me up to take me to the football game. And so excited, I reached on the counter to pick up my little Fujitsu camera that I had bought while I was in the Marine Corps. And I pulled it off the counter, it hit the floor and broke in about 6 or 7 different pieces.
Oh, no.
Alvin had two cameras, a 35 and a 2.25. He handed me a Yashica Mat 124G, which I still have today. And he said, man, you can shoot with this. I fell in love with that medium format. And I've used that medium format as my primary camera all of the years. I carry two cameras with me because a lot of time the subject dictates the format. And it's the instant of a moment that is most important to me. I don't make a lot of pictures of one subject. If I got to make more than 4 pictures of the subject or 5 pictures, something is wrong. I'm not feeling what I'm seeing. Wow. And I have to be able to see and to feel. It has to excite me in such a way that it's the most important thing for me at that moment. I made that mistake of making that statement to my wife, who is now deceased. The photography is the most important thing. And she roasted that to me several times, but we laughed and we talked about it and it all turned out good. She was my, she was my greatest supporter. Yep. And you're looking at the picture here called Cooling Waters. I was leaving the campus one day and there is a housing project across the street. And this little boy was out there standing in the yard, or he might have been in the tub of water, but he had the hose pipe and he was doing it. So I immediately stopped and grabbed my camera and went over there and made this photograph. In my travel, where I go, everywhere I go, I carry a camera with me. And that's the reason why I bought the little small Leica, because it's not as intrusive as a larger camera. Mm-hmm. And when people see me out, they would say, I think I know you. And then people would say, Hudnall, where's your camera? Are you still making photographs? Yes, and most time, I'll reach under my arm and I'll pull out and I'll have my camera. And so I carry a camera wherever I go. And if I hadn't had the camera, I could not have made this picture.
I'm so glad you had your camera.
Yeah.
Let's advance to the next one.
Okay. Flipping Boy. And this photograph is made in Fourth Ward, which is a community west of downtown that was dissected by Highway 49, but yet and still Freemantown survived for a number of years up until the early 2000s. It was a community that was founded by free slaves. This is the first community during the Model Cities program where I began to photograph. And I fell in love with Fourth Ward, and I would go out there every weekend to make photographs when I was free from the university. Due to the fact that the community was closed, people sit on their porches. Now you see in a two-story duplex kind of a shotgun house, but a lot of people had small little clapboard shotgun houses that was close together, and they could sit on their porches and then talk to the neighbor to the left of them and to the right of them. This is how close the houses was. Now, this was before, I think it was a Black History Month program or whatever. And one of the TV stations was out and they had wanted to do a little story about my photography. And they asked me to meet them in Fourth Ward. And so we was there for filming. And this little boy came up and he said, look, I can turn flips. And so he started flipping up and down the street. So I kneeled down and I made this picture, and it's called Flipping Boy.
Wow.
And that's how it was made at that time. Mm-hmm.
That's tremendous. Let's move on to the next one. I know we're down to the final 10 minutes before we get to the Q&A.
Okay.
We're gonna move through some of these a bit faster, but
this is a shotgun house in the Third Ward area off of Emancipation, which was at one time, it was named Dowling Street. But this particular photograph, every month, the owner of this house or the person who was renting this house did a kind of religious expression. And this is one of them, Lord Jesus, Heavenly from God. And so you would see these kinds of things within the community. And the good thing about the next week that you come, the porch may change, the chairs may not be there, either the sign on the top of the house may not be there. And these things was constantly changing. And then you would come back again and the house wouldn't be there because the landlord, because of gentrification, would begin to sell the property and move on.
Wow, incredible. Let's advance to the next.
Ha ha.
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. hip hop. I was teaching a class down in Galveston, Texas, at the Galveston Arts Center with a mentor of mine named Clint Willow. He had asked me if I would be interested in teaching a summer class to kids within the housing project. They had to photograph their hopes, their dreams, and their desires. They took the cameras home, made photographs, bought them back. And the way in which we selected photographs, they had to put their three best pictures up on the wall. And then as a group, we selected 25 or 30 up from that. So in the afternoons, when I was free, because I was staying in Galveston, which was 50 miles from Houston, I would walk and make photographs for myself. And as I was walking through Cedar Terry Housing Project that day, this little boy was standing up there. And he said, hey, mister, make my picture. He didn't say, well, I'll take your picture. He said, make my picture. And I said, okay. And so this is how he posed. I made two shots, him straight on this way. And then he turned with a hat to the side of his head. And I came back, I developed the film and I looked at it. And okay, it was a picture. I took it to the gallery and Susan jumped up and she looked at it and she jumped on the telephone. And she said, she called someone and said, Earlie just bought in this killer photograph. And I said, what's so unusual about it? So that afternoon, I went over to John Bigger's house. John was my mentor. That's where I spent most of my time with. He was lying on the sofa and he was asleep. When I walked in, I said, Papa John, I got a picture I want you to look at. And he looked at it. He said, hey, boy. He said, that's hip hop. I said, hip hop? He said, yeah, man, you don't know what hip hop is? He said, come on, Hudnall. And that's how the photograph got the name hip hop. And it's been in a lot of schools, work study programs for kids to make comments on and to write about. They talk about that matter that he's wearing a beeper, the way in which he dressed, imitation of adults, or the gold chains and so forth and all, and as to where he is today. Matter of fact, there was a photograph on exhibit downtown about 2 months ago, and he sent a picture to the gallery, him standing by the picture.
The young man in the picture.
Yeah, the young man in the picture
That was 1993. So we're talking about
1993. That was 30 years ago, at Houston First at the George R. Brown Convention Center, and he sent a picture and inquired about it at the gallery in Dallas, and it was a picture of him that was shot standing next to it, and it is him. Yep.
So I'm imagining, so that was 93. I'm imagining now he's around 44, 43 years old, perhaps around that.
That's correct.
So let's move on to the next photo as well.
Okay. Here we go. This picture was made, I think it was in 1982. It's called Jump Rope. And this is typical of kids that is playing. And it was unusual for me to see this in Houston. So as I was passing, luckily I had my camera, I stopped and made the picture. A lot of time I walk in the community and I'll see sights and see things. But this was just so natural that I didn't have to say anything, and they was there. You know, they had what they would do, we call hopscotch, and they would draw on the sidewalks. We would do it at home, back home, in the dirt, and we would use glass and numbers and so forth and on, and we would shoot marbles. So this was a typical scene of kids playing during the summertime that caused me to reminisce and to go back, and it was one that I had wanted to capture. And I did this, I ended up doing this undisturbing, you know, the kids that particular way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it reminds me of growing up too. It's a perfect photo, perfect. Let's advance to the next.
Lady in Black Hat with Feathers. This, a city councilman, Justin Robinson had passed, and his funeral was at St. John's Church. I used to work for a small newspaper called The Informer here in Houston, and Mr. McElroy had sent me down to get some photographs primarily of the funeral or whatever, and I elected to photograph the coffin coming out of the church. And after I had ended up doing this, this lady was standing on the steps there, and she never changed her position. And it was a pose that she was more or less in a trance. And I made this picture of her, and it's called Lady in Black Hat with Feathers. We never spoke. I think that she acknowledged that I was making the photograph, and that was it. A lot of time, I do not hold a conversation with my subject prior to making the picture. And due to the fact, if I have eye contact and a person do not want me to make the picture, I don't. But most time, once they make contact with me, they give me permission to make the photograph. And I do that due to the fact that when I see the person, this is what I want at that moment, that instant of a moment. After that instant of a moment, it's dead, it's gone. And I can make a photograph, but it's not what I saw that I wanted at the time.
Right.
And that's what it was. Yeah. Uh-huh.
And that spontaneity, that difference between, you know, capturing a moment versus, say, being a painter, right? Which is a whole different thing. But just, you know, that has to be so exhilarating when you see something and you know that's the thing. Like,
that's it. Well, as I move about, I never stage photograph. In the community, I don't stage photograph. Sometimes people come together and say, do this group shot for us, do this. And I'll do it and bring them back a photograph. But what I do for myself, I never stage a picture. I may move left to right to cause the person to turn because something is behind them, is growing out from the back of their head, but I never stage a photograph.
Mm-hmm. I mean, this particular photo, I spent a lot of time looking at this photo before our discussion today. I mean, this woman reminds me of my aunts, my cousins, my mother in some regards. It's something so, you know, to say regal is almost cliche. I mean, I'm sure you've heard that many times.
Yeah. And also it reminds me of the time that my grandmother and my mother and some of her friends would be talking. My grandmother was a day worker. She worked for Merle and Claude Williams, and she worked for $3.50 a day. She did. And she would talk about, they were talking about going to Cressy's or to Ben Franklin and finding their Easter hat that they wanted and putting it on what we don't hear about today, layaway. 50 cents down, a dollar down, and put it on layaway. And you can pay it out just before Easter. My grandmother would make her dress and so forth and on. And on Easter Sunday, the ladies would come to church. And those were the true crowns that they wore. And they wore them very regal and so forth. So also, it reminded me of that. And so those are the kind of things that come to mind.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. I could look at this photo all day. Yeah. It's so great. So let's move on. Let's move on. I think we have three more before we get to Q&A.
Mother and sons, this was on a Sunday morning. This was during the Model Cities program. They were resurfacing the streets and so forth and on and improving that. And this lady and her two sons was walking and on their way to church. And I saw them. And as I saw them approaching, I started smiling and kneel down to make the picture. Rather than standing, I decided to kneel because I wanted them to feel very regal from that stand. And she said, just a moment. She stopped and took the tail of her dress and she wiped the eyes, be sure that it was clean. And this is how they end up posing for me.
Yeah, yeah, the love of a mother, you know?
Yeah, mother and sons, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mother, wow. And so I think this is the final one coming up here.
Okay, my thinking time. Again, this is across the street from the university called CUNY Homes. I will go over to make some photographs. And this lady was out there working in her garden and she stopped to think and to lean on the hoe. And I think I spoke to her and I acknowledged and she acknowledged me and from there. But it reminded me of an aunt who I had that lived across the street from us that we called Duke. And she worked in her front yard. She cut all the grass out. She kept it down to the clay dirt and she would sweep it. Then she would work in her garden and she never allowed a horse in there to plow. She worked it by hand. And it kind of reminded me of that. And I love the simplicity of the dress and the pose that which she had. And again, here we go, that instant of a moment that I made this image. And so I love it. I made this picture back in 1977.
Let me tell you, you know, there's always so many different things that I could say about your photographs, but to me, her hand, that left hand,
sure,
everything about that hand just speaks to me, you know, it just speaks of just effort and strength.
Yeah.
So
now that you mention that, not cutting you off.
Sure.
John Biggers, my mentor, the hands was extremely important in his photograph. His mother was a washerwoman, but in the very beginning, he could not draw hands and he couldn't do feet. So he did a series of drawings on hands and feet until he mastered that after he came out of Africa. And so I have some of those drawings, but the hand, the strength of the hand is ultimately important in the photograph. It is. Uh-huh.
Yeah, hands and feet are not easy. I'm not an artist, but I know from talking to artists that hands and feet, you got to get those hands and feet right.
That is correct. Uh-huh.
So we have a few questions that have come in. So the first one is, have you published any monographs, any books of your work?
Not as of yet.
Incredible.
Yeah. The gallery is talking about that as we speak.
Oh, but that's long overdue.
Yeah, truly it is. It's well long overdue. This is one of the reasons why I made the decision to really to leave the university in 2019 to be able to devote more time to my own personal work. I've got bodies of work that I still would love to revisit and to do some things and negatives that I haven't printed. And I like to bring things together because it was difficult to pick out the extra 3 or 4 pictures to send to you, you know, from that standpoint of view, because my photographs are like family. And so bringing them together and trying to determine exactly how I'm going to do this and how I'm going to do that. It's always good when someone else curates something and I see the potential of what is there. But no, at this time, I have had conversation with the University of Texas. And so I'll see where it goes. But hopefully within the next year, I come up with a publication.
Well, you already sold a few. I'm buying three. So
okay,
as soon as they're available. The other question that came in is kind of goes back to when you were talking about being on campus. So were the Black photographers on campus organized? Were there groups?
Well, there was a program that Mr. Herbert Provost and Miss Louise Martin. Miss Louise Martin won a Pulitzer Prize for photographing Mrs. Coretta Cox King at Dr. Martin Luther King funeral. Mr. Provost was a school photographer, but he was famous for photographing a photograph of Elvis Presley, and I don't forget who the other person was, and a photograph of a person who had been beaten by the NAACP. But he was a tennis coach at TSU, and that motivation came from the two of them to start what we call the Black Photographers on campus. And it was made up of students, and it was made up of photographers within the community. But mind you, most of them was in the business to make a living. I had a job, a resource from the campus. So when I would leave campus, I was free to be able to hone my craft in the direction in which I wanted to from a documentary standpoint of view. And so, sure, I shot weddings. I took some commercial jobs on the side. All of this I had to do in order to survive. I used to go to what was called an oil show at the Astrodome at the time and photograph there. The Enron building downtown, which was the world's largest continuous concrete pour at the time. Got up at 4:30 in the morning to go down there. 100 cement trucks lined up to pour this foundation, to go there and to be able to make photographs. For me, it was an opportunity, and opportunities only come once. And so I was always out doing that, but the photographic club did exist. It did thrive for a while, and then it fell off. And as they say, in the last turn, when the bear jump on you, the ones who can't keep up drops off. But on campus, we would have an annual photographers competition at the end of the year. And after the football games, after big events, we would do displays of photographs, the photographic club. I was president of the photographic club 1 year. And so we would do those kinds of things.
Wow. So another question, before I even jump on the question, it's something you said I want to spend a moment on, because I think it's really, really important, about how having other income streams from work allowed you to do what you want to do. Mm-hmm. I just think that is something that is really relevant for a lot of artists today in terms of thinking about how to make the work they want to make without all the pressures of being, a commercial artist. And again, we're down to the last 9 minutes, so I don't want to go too far down the rabbit hole here. But I just would love if you could just speak another moment to that freedom that you found as a photographer, not having to make work for someone else. It seems to me you were making the work for yourself.
Of course. Well, it goes back to the art department and what John Biggers taught us. The art educational program at TSU was important. He said it would afford the artist to be able to have a job. You can get a job as a teacher. You can do this. And then you was free to practice your own work. Edward Mills, a great painter, told Dr. Biggers, he said, "Doc, I think I'm going to become a sign painter." He said, "Boy, you better get you a job teaching or doing something. You can't make a living a painting sign." So that stuck with me. So I had the resources of working on campus for a couple of little programs that paid me $200 a month or $250 a month. And then I was able to pick up a little commercial job. But after I was through with that commercial job, I was free to do what I wanted to do. I made some pictures for Ebony Magazine. They asked me to do a picture of Akeem Olajuwon. And I made the picture of Akeem Olajuwon. But I went beyond that. I went out to his place and I made several photographs. So they end up doing a whole spread on Akeem Olajuwon. So I made more money. So I photographed him with his daughter at the piano. I photographed him in the kitchen. I photographed him in his house. I photographed him on the outside on the basketball court. And so I expanded. I end up doing, and that's what I would say to photographers, don't take any shortcuts. Do what you have to do to make a living, and then practice and hone your own craft according to how you want to do it. This becomes your signature, and this is the only way to do it. There's no shortcuts. Even with digital, you can manipulate it and you can do things, but the camera, the art of seeing, looking through the lens, snapping, depressing the shutter, that's the image that you have to work with. That's what you have to live with. And that's what carries you to wherever you go.
So there's two more questions
okay.
that came in on chat, and I'll put those ahead of my own questions.
Okay. I'll do it as quickly as I can. Okay.
So someone asked about your relationship, friendship with John Biggers. Did you ever travel to North Carolina with John Biggers?
Yes, I did. I was at John Biggers' house every day from 1970 up until 2019, up until 2002 when he passed, and beyond that with Hazel, his wife. When John went to Hampton to do an artist in residence, he left the keys to his house and his studio with me and my wife. And so we kind of monitored his house, sent the mail to them. When John built a place and bought a place in North Carolina, we traveled, went up there. John had a retrospective at Hampton University. He introduced me to Gene Ziegler, who was the curator up there. And I ended up having a show at Hampton University. And Hampton bought the whole entire show of 66 photographs. And so my John Biggers were my surrogate, I would say like a surrogate father to me. I went to their house. I ate on Sunday. I could go there whenever I wanted to. I had keys to the house. I had keys to the car. I had keys to his studio. And so I was there on a daily basis, almost, if not a daily basis, every week. I was at John Biggers' house. And so a lot of the influences in my work was inspired by the work of John Biggers. And it goes back to that thing, art is life.
Yeah, amen to that. So another question here is, do you have a particular emotive intention when you take and especially edit your photographs? So that's the question. Is there an intent of what you're trying to convey?
No, not really. It's just a matter of what stands out to me from this subject. I do in some instances because I look at the struggle of people on a day-to-day basis, how we survive, how single mothers survive and take care of their kids, how people survive, I would say that is without, as we want to say, homeless or whatever, or however. And I never approach my subject from a negative standpoint of view. But when I go into the dark room, I look at my negatives, I try to find something positive about how that person strives to survive and how unique that they are able to improvise and live and survive in this society. And so when I look at my work, I don't have an intent that this is what I want to do. It's that instant of a moment. Once that instant of the moment is there, beyond that, it's gone. I just pull it all together as best I can.
And one of my final questions for this evening, and thank you. I mean,
okay.
You're so easy to interview. Thank you so much. So what are you working on now?
I'm printing and organizing. I have a lot of CDs from the university. I kept a copy of everything I've ever done. And so I have those. I need to organize those and put them in some sort of order. I'm not the best person from a technological standpoint of view, but I got external hard drives and I'm categorizing things there. And I'm still printing negatives. I got stuff from South Africa that I want to print. I got a couple of images left from Haiti that I need to finish. I got stuff from Europe that I haven't printed. I got things here within the city of Houston. As I travel, wherever I go, I tell you, I carry a camera. So I have bodies of works, semi-bodies of works, but yet and still, the thing of it is, the universality of the human spirit is what I try to capture. I got pictures from South Africa that I can take and put with pictures from Third Ward. I got pictures from Haiti that I can take and put with pictures from Third Ward. John Bigger said, Hudnall, when you go to Haiti, he said, it's the closest thing you will see to Africa in the Western Hemisphere. And that was so very, very, very true. But getting off the beaten path, understanding and being sensitive to how we live with the elements, how we live with and how we live with without, how we endure, how we struggle, how family stays together, how family love and how family embrace each other. These are the things that is important to me. Always have, always will be. And these are the kinds of things and events that I will try to capture.
I could not think of a better way to wrap up this conversation. That is so good. So good. I just want to thank you again for your time. You know, I know that, as I mentioned earlier, you know, this wasn't the easiest time to plan an event like this because of everything that's going on, you know, in Texas and other parts of the country. So once again, you know, I really appreciate your time and joining us today. I also just want to say that your work, some of the works that we showed here during this presentation are actually on view at the Harvey B. Gantt Center. So I would recommend that everyone who's joined us today go onto the Gantt Center's website. And if you're in North Carolina, in Charlotte, sign up so you can have timed entry. I want to thank everyone here for joining this conversation. It's important that we deepen our understanding of the artist's experience to see the true power of their work. The Gantt Center has continuously provided programs to the community that highlight arts and culture. With your support, the Gantt Center can expand their work and connection to the community it serves. By texting the word unmasked to the number 345-345, you can conveniently support the continuation of these programs. To learn more about the ways you can support the Gantt Center, visit their website, gantcenter.org. Stay tuned for next month's must-see open-air conversation on March 16th at 7 p.m. as we discuss another artist's journey with a special featured artist in the current exhibition, Vision and Spirit, African-American artworks from the Bank of America collection. I want to thank you all again. I want to thank you, Mr. Earlie Hudnall Jr. Thank you so much for your generosity.
And if anyone is interested in contacting me, get in touch with Bert and Missy Fingers at Photographs Do Not Bend in Dallas, Texas. So if they would do that, they can be in touch by either earliehudnall@icloud.com.
Thank you so much. Have a great evening and stay safe.
I will. And thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.